chapter 2 this morning. Acts chapter 2. I don't know about you. I totally forgot it's about St. Patrick's Day. And when we were growing up, when we forgot to wear green, we used to get pinched. Is that the way you guys did that or not? Is that just like something my mom did to me or what? Is there other people that were pinched when you didn't wear green? Okay, there's a few. Okay, well, I don't want to be pinched. But I did forget to wear green. So some people say, well, you're Irish. I'm not Irish either. I'm a lot of different things, but I'm not Irish. So celebrate the day. Drink some green tea or something. I don't know. But Acts chapter 2. Amazingly enough, 3 days. 3 days. Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. I'm in chapel this week with you, and I want to speak about worship, but more specifically the church. Friday, we're going to speak about priority and my personal worship with God. And tomorrow, I would like to give a very practical PowerPoint presentation, biblical points, topically, about how to find a church. And you say, well, why would you talk about how to find a church? And I've been approached by students before to ask me, when I graduate, how do I find a church? And quite honestly, as students here, when you get thrust into a new college setting, I think sometimes we go and we say, well, I need to find a church that matches this, this, this in my mind. And that may not be necessarily the best thing. So I would like to give three thoughts tomorrow. And those thoughts are the practical things that I would look for in a church, the spiritual things that I look for in a church, and the selfish things that often we look for in a church that really are not scriptural. And so just to get your mind flowing on this so that you can wrestle through this with me, when I look at the New Testament, and a lot of times my heart is broken when I hear young people and older Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ, tell me that they're leaving a church and it's for reasons that I can't find in the Scripture. Because I believe as God's children, we need to look into God's Word to have really good reasons. And a lot of times what I'm hearing is, well, this church is not meeting my need. Or I am not getting this any longer, and I'm not getting this any longer. And just to let you know how I'm wrestling through with it, I have to admit to you, I don't see that in Scripture. And so when I look into Scripture and I read the New Testament, oftentimes I see people who are encouraged to stick things out for the sake of the gospel and not just leave because they don't feel like their needs are being met. And see, this speaks to everybody in here, because at all times most everybody has felt like, even your parents, I'm going to leave a church. And whether or not that's right or wrong is in the hand of the parents and of you, but I'm giving you the thoughts that I've been wrestling with when it comes to this. The other thing I'm concerned about for this day and age is the idea, because yes, I'm older, but the idea for young people, young adults that are entering into the churches of today, to be committed to a local church. Not just in the form of the way the guide says it, but to really be committed to a church and say, you know what, this is where God has me, this is where I'm going to serve, and I'm going to get in there and be a part of the body of Christ, which Christ has called me to do. Be a part of it. And I think sometimes we want to find a church and we want it to meet our needs, but we're not willing to be a part of the body of Christ. We're not willing to use the talents that God has given us. And that's very important in God's Word. Think about this in Ephesians chapter 5. Now, you know, we're going to go to Acts chapter 2, so I'm just asking you to think about this, but I'm going to read it. We just sang the song, Precious Lamb of Glory. The teaching technically seems to be for husbands and wives, but listen to the way Christ loves the church. That is the motive for these 3 days. He says in verse 23, Paul writes this, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. And he goes on to make these statements. Verse 32, this is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Christ loves the universal church. Christ loves the local church. And if it's something that he loves, whether or not I've cultivated that love in my life right now, I need to cultivate that in my life for the future. Because that is where the life of Christ's unity is to be. How many of us in here, this is including faculty and staff, because you're looking at the worst offender in my attitude towards Christ's place in which he loves, how many of us in here can't wait to get to our local body on Sunday mornings? Or how many of us in here go through the debate of, well, if I was on my own and I didn't have to fill out a form on Tuesday, would I go to Sunday school and would I be on in church on Sunday night if my service had that, if my church had that? Would I actually do that? Do you really love the ministry that God has given you, and are you a part of it? Well, what we're going to do today is in Acts chapter 2, we're going to look at the first church. And we're going to see distinctives in that, and I'm just going to submit to you today that in the grid of people calling churches church today, go ahead and do the church that you go to or the churches that you've seen, and go ahead and take this grid and see if this matches up scripturally. And I'm going to submit to you that many times we sometimes have these selfish expectations, but in Acts chapter 2, we see what happens in the early church. We're going to look at the whole chapter, different sections. But just to let you know, the other day, last night, I was, we're just getting moved into our house. We moved in November, but putting up pictures is a six-month process. Okay? My wife, it's like a puzzle to her. So she wants different things to go different places. And if you come into our house, and we invite you to come, not all 500 at once, but if you'd like to come, just let me know. I'm looking forward to watching NCAA basketball religiously, and if you'd like to do that, come. But if you come in over to our dining room, there's a buffet right there, and right beside there are three letters from presidents, President Bush the first, President Bush the second, and Bill Clinton. Because when my wife, at that time fiance, we were engaged, she sent them all wedding invitations. And so they got responses back. Beside those that are framed, those responses from the presidents, is a picture of my wife for her engagement, for her bridal pictures. And then as I was walking up the stairs, because I just kind of noticed this, and I looked, and on the stairs going up, I don't know where she's going to put it, is a picture of us on our wedding day. And I looked at it, and I said, Ryan, you look different than 15 years ago, you know? And I was sitting there, I was just trying to evaluate it. Maybe I'll scan it and show you the pictures tomorrow morning. But then I get upstairs, and in our bedroom, there's pictures of our three kids. You know, they send out these things, and they say, come buy one picture, we'll give you one for free. And as young parents, you're like, oh, this is a great deal, and you get in there and pay $100, you know, and you're like, oh, they just got me on this. But all the pictures are so cute, and we have these pictures, and there's this picture of Connor, and Gracie and Tanner are on top of him, just they're playing and laughing, things like that. And I'm sitting there like, are those my kids? That's a long time ago. I can't even remember holding my kids any longer. You say, man, your brain is dead. Yeah, it's really like that. Life goes so quick. And the metamorphosis of time. We just look older, don't we? When I graduated from college, I sat there and I said, you know, all the clothes that I'm wearing, they'll be in 20 years from now. And I look back at it, and everybody has poofy hair. And everybody looks older or kind of hickish or something, and something's going on. And I'm like, it's changed. I've changed. I've got gray hair all over the place sprouting up. I've got hair falling out of the top of my head. Man, I can go right now and probably, I don't want to mess my hair up, but I could probably grab right now and just get a couple, and you could watch them floating down if you were close enough. Hair's just falling out. It's called metamorphosis. Something's taking place. I'm getting older. But you know what takes place sometimes when we look at these things? The church seems to be going through a metamorphosis. And the question is does the New Testament church match up with the original church? Let me give you a couple of things here. The challenge would be this. How does the church, your church, measure up to the first church of the first century church? Okay, so here's where we look at the common thread throughout chapter 2. And let's remember this. I'm not going to read. We'll start at verse 12. It says, they were all amazed, were in doubt, saying to one another, what meaneth this? There was a revival taking place. It's called the Day of Pentecost. The church at Jerusalem technically is being established, and you see it taking place when they appoint deacons so that the apostles can concentrate on prayer and the word. And we have this incredible thing taking place, and people are starting to speak in tongues so that other people from different nations can understand the message of the gospel and who Jesus Christ is. And it's interesting that the people around them who didn't want to believe what was taking place, it says in verse 13, others mocking said, these men are full of new wine. Here are people that are coming to know Jesus Christ, the Messiah, who had been gone for a short period of time, and the people around them said, they're drunk. And I would submit to you today, in the early beginnings of the church, one of the things that seems to be missing in the church today is persecution. Now, just so that you know, I meant to say this in the beginning, but I got talking. Just so that you know, this is a message that I heard from Pastor McLaughlin in Huntsville, Alabama. The points are not mine. The scripture is the same. The points are not mine. But here's what is missing: persecution. Christ said in his message, and our pastor has been preaching about this 2 weeks ago, but Christ said that blessed are the persecuted. And the question I have for you today is, our churches giving a message that really kind of steps on our toes every week and is counterculture? We keep on hearing people say, we've got to reach the culture. We've got to reach the culture. We've got to reach the culture. But in technicality, when I look at the Old Testament, it's more so people, the Gentiles, the pagans, seeing who God's glory is, and they go to that. They don't say, let's change to invite them. Have you ever been persecuted for your faith? This American concept of persecution is not, I can't do my laundry this week. Persecution is not saying, I don't have $3,000 to pay my school bill. These men and women, until Constantine came on the scene, these men and women were being killed for naming the name of Christ. How many of you read Fox's Book of Martyrs? An incredible compilation of people at times who would just say, I believe that baptism by immersion is biblical, and die for it. And I wonder, in my mind, is if somebody had to put my life on the line, and you, and somebody came in, and they, as many examples in Fox's Book of Martyrs, that these depraved, despicable people who did not want people to name the name of Christ would shackle these men and shackle these women and parade their children in front of them and torture their children. What in the world would I do? How much would I sacrifice for that? That's persecution. The worst I've had as a pastor is to tell somebody that they're living in sin, and the guy actually came over top of I was thankful to have my assistant pastor with me. He came over top of my desk, which was pretty big, grabbed me, and wrestled me to the ground. And he was pretty strong. You say, well, you look pretty strong. No, well, I'm not. But he got me down on the ground, and I'm like, calling my assistant pastor. I'm like, help, you know. And the guy locked on to me. That's the worst persecution I can think of in my life, for telling somebody that they were living in sin. These people were sacrificing every day of their lives, family members, for the sake of the gospel. And young people, I don't know what's going to happen 50 years from now. But are you ready to do that for Christ who loves us so much? I mean, do you have the type of commitment to Jesus Christ that you're willing to give your life for it? And I have to sit here today and say, until the time happens, I hope I get stronger. But until the time happens, I don't know how I will respond. I hope that I respond certain ways. But I'm looking at a lot of young men and young women, especially some of our athletes. You guys are so strong. You guys work out all the time. I am amazed at the amount of commitment you have to that, and that strength is incredible. Are you willing to stand up for your Lord the same way? Are you willing to do that? Persecution seems to be missing. The message of the gospel seems to be watered down. I need to look at this. Look at what happens in the church. Just look at a couple passages or a couple verses after that. Chapter 4 and verse 18 says this. Peter and John were ministering, and they called them and commanded them not to speak or at all, nor teach in the name of Jesus. So they had this message, and they're going around and they're telling people, the worst that's ever happened to any of us is maybe we've been kicked out of the mall, or a security guard has come up and said, you can't hand out tracts here. In chapter 5 and verse 26, the scriptures say, then went the captain with the officers and brought them without violence, for they feared the people, lest they should have been stoned. Verse 33 says this, when they heard that, they were cut to the heart and took counsel to slay them. The message of Jesus Christ, it cuts against people. You know why? Because it's Jesus Christ. The Lord of Lords. Shares his throne with no one. He's God. And when people say today in our culture, well, you believe that Christ is God, and that's okay, but I believe in Muhammad, and that's okay, that is not okay with Christ. And I want to present the message in grace and not cut off a relationship, but the truth is, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, go into hell. That's truth. That's real. And that cuts to the heart of people that don't want it. And these people didn't want that. You can look at chapter 8 and verse 3. The continuation of the persecution, 8 chapter 3 says this, Saul, before he was Paul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hailing men and women, committing them to prison. I just haven't had that happen to me for the sake of the gospel. Persecution seems to be missing. Christ did not call the church to a life of comfort. In other words, I would actually say that Christ many times says, pain is good. Let the trial of your faith work what? Patience. So Christ isn't telling me to come to Him so that I can go to heaven, which is a great benefit of knowing Him. But He tells me and calls me and says, Ryan, if you know me, you better pick up your cross and follow me. And you better love me than your mom or dad and your brother and sister. And you better get ready, because my message cuts against the grain of society, and people don't like to hear that it's their problem. People don't like to hear that. Persecution seems to be missing from the church today. I would even submit at times that preaching about Christ is missing from the church. Peter, standing up in verse 14, begins to give this message, and he says, you men of Judea and all that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you and hearken to my words. And as you look down, He begins to give an incredible statement about Jesus Christ. In verse 20 it says, "The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and notable day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Ye men of Israel, hear these words, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, as you yourselves also know." You know, today, young people, brothers and sisters in Christ, it seems that the distinction is not saying to people, "Do you know God?" Because a lot of people define God in a different way. My kids and I went into a restaurant when we were up in Baltimore, and I was blessed by a person bowing their head to pray. And usually when I see other people praying, I'm assuming they're Christians. And I went over to this individual and I said, "I know the Lord Jesus as my Savior. I want to let you know it was a blessing to see you pray." And he looked at me and said, "I did not pray to Jesus Christ. I'm a Christian scientist. A Scientologist." He said, "I prayed to a Scientologist." He said, "I'm a Scientologist." So it's not enough sometimes just to look at people and say, "Do you know God?" Because God is defined in many different ways. But God, Jehovah God, sent His only Son, whose name is Jesus, who people need. And see, the preaching of the early church was exactly that. It was not, "You need God." The Israelites knew they needed God. The Sadducees and the Pharisees worshiped God every day. They had their own product of religion. What they needed was Jesus Christ, because He was the Messiah. And that's the non-negotiable of what we serve today, is a Savior who has risen from the dead. He was approved from God in verse 22, or of God in verse 22. He was appointed by God, determined. Verse 23, "Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain." He was appointed by God. He was approved by God. But He also spoke with accusation. And this is something that sometimes I think the preaching of Christ does in our life. Can I ask you a question, brothers and sisters in Christ? When you go to church, do you get your toes stepped on? We live in a day and age when all of the preaching seems to be about, "I need something to help me with my family, and I need something to help me with my self-esteem, and I need something to help me with my emotions." But the fact of the matter is, the things that help me get rid of that in my life is the recognition that I'm a sinful man. And I need that in my life, and I need accusation. Accusation was right here in verse 36. It says, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know," after he goes through this whole thing of Jesus Christ. And in verse 23, he says, "whom you have slain." That's accusation. And in verse 36, he says, "assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified." I would submit to you, that's convicting preaching. And sometimes we, in our church decisions, we sit there and say, "Well, what church in the message is going to meet my needs the best?" But you know what my need is? To be sanctified. To hear preaching on the cross. To know that I am still desperately wicked. And my heart every day wants to sin against my Savior, wants to sin against my wife, wants to sin against my ministry. My heart every day wants to do what I want to do. And I need to be purified daily. If you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you believe the authority of Scripture, and you are a sinner, so do you. We need preaching that is accusatory today. And if we go to churches where we never hear about how to change in our lives and the sin we need to deal with, that's not going to help us. I think one of the greatest things about going to church and opening your heart to the Word of God is being able to be convicted. And knowing that some reason, and every time the Lord allows somebody to preach from this pulpit, at least in my case, every time since I've been here, God has allowed me to speak, I can say this. Somebody in this building always comes to me and says, that message was for me. You know what the blessing of that is? My word will not return unto me void. That's what it means. Conviction is from the Holy Spirit. And whether it encourages us or steps on our toes or makes us make a point of decision or gets us to chew theologically a little bit more, we need to be challenged. And if we pick a church where we don't get challenged from the preaching, and we don't hear, hey, listen, if you're not giving to the local church, something's wrong with your finances. And if we meet on Sunday nights and you're skipping it, something's wrong in your life. And if you're watching something or listening to something that doesn't please the holiness of our God, that's a sinful expression of your heart. We need preaching on sin. And that's accusatory. I think the thing that makes my blood boil the most is that we've even turned the message of salvation into a commitment. You watch what's being said on TV today. And you have men and women getting up there and saying, friend, do you need God? Commit your life to Him right now. I'm going to submit to you, that is not salvation. Everybody commits their life to God. God, I know I'm in trouble. If you get me out of this, I'll serve you. That's not salvation. That might be grace. That's not salvation. Salvation is that if any man confess the Lord Jesus and believe in his heart that God hath raised him from the dead, he'll be saved. Preaching about Christ is what is needed. We need to be challenged about what we are thinking and who we are serving. We need preaching on sin. And I am the biggest offender. I need this. I need accusatory preaching. They were pricked in the heart. Verse 37 says this, that when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? They came to a point of decision because they heard accusatory preaching. Preaching about Christ. Their conscience was pricked. And once again, the church needs pain sometimes, but I just find myself running from pain. Do you run from pain? I tell you, what a blessing a Sleep Number bed is.
I love it.
At first, my wife bought it for us, and she's like, we need this. I said, no, I like my bed. And you set it up, and it takes off forever long, and if you lay it over the wrong way, you're in trouble, and you have to pull everything up again, and I'm just getting all mad. She sets hers, and she's like sleeping like a rock. For 2 weeks, I feel like I'm not sleeping at all. And we pump it up, and it's... And, you know, I have to get off the bed because with how much weight I am, you know, I got to get out of the bed to firm things up because this is already too firm, and it just flattens it anyways. And for 2 weeks, I'm sitting there complaining until I found my Sleep Number. And when I found my Sleep Number, life was good. You know, and when I found that part in my life where I sat there and I said, you know, I was sleeping in pain until I found my Sleep Number. And the reality of a Christian's life is sometimes we just sit there and say, I just want my Sleep Number all the time. But that's not the Christian life. We need to be pricked in our conscience. We need to be pricked in our heart about the preaching of Jesus Christ. And there's always the prerequisite of sin. Verse 38 says this, Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. We need the prerequisite of sin. Repentance is missing at some churches today. Repentance. Very popular preacher on 60 Minutes made this statement, I cannot preach on sin. I'm a preacher of grace. I cannot see where God tells the man of God to preach the whole counsel of God and say you cannot preach on sin. product of the word is what's great in this church. They that gladly received, in verse 41, were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, and all that believed were together, and all had things in common. You know, when we have this type of unity, and God's word is being preached, and Jesus Christ crucified and risen again, and repentance is seen, and people are pricked in their hearts, then we have the product, and that is church unity. That is, we are together in this. That is, we want to serve God. And young people, I would say to you, staff and faculty, Ryan Dupee, I'm speaking this to me today. I would say to us that these things in the first century church should be prevalent in a church that is thriving today. They need to be there. In 1984, in Bogota, Colombia, a young lady with her five-year-old son went into a hospital and said, My son is ill, and I don't know what it is. And the doctor looked at her and said, we're going to have to keep him overnight. So she decided to leave the baby there and left overnight and came back the next morning. And they checked the lady out immediately. And she knew something was wrong because when she got there that morning, she had to pick up her five-year-old son because he had bandages around his eyes. And she couldn't understand. This is a true story. She couldn't understand. She brought him in because he was sick, and they said they needed to keep him overnight. Those doctors were frauds. And they took out the child's eyes to sell them on the black market. She walked away with her five-year-old son, who now was blind, because people would take them. God's word gives us eyes to see how he wants his church to be run. And my fear is if we don't hold to the scriptures, that we're allowing Satan very subtly to get behind the eyes of our blindness, and he's just taking them out, and we're walking blindly if we don't do things by God's word. Now, I do hope that God's word convicts me. I hope the same for you. But may I say to you, as a brother in Christ who really wants the best for your life, will you please set up biblical reasons why you do what you do? Will you really think about it instead of just saying, well, this is the kind of church I went to growing up, or this is what mom and dad did, or this is what the college said, or this is what... Will you please set up biblical things and reasons in your life of why you do what you do? Because if we don't, we're just all blind people. The truth of God's word makes a difference. May God help us to see that. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the love you shower upon us. And thank you for the model you give us in Acts chapter 2 of this incredible beginning of a church. And I just pray, Lord, that you will help us to see that today. I pray that it would raise questions and raise discussions. And Lord, I know that all of my opinions implemented into this, that goes to the wayside. I pray that we would stick to the truth of your word, and we'll thank you for it. Give these students a wonderful day. We continue to pray for Jessica as her little body right now is being worked on for this tumor. And I pray that you would be with the doctors and be with the family. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.